buddy, Arata. You're sitting at your desk with a test in front of you. The question is there, and you are sure that you know the answer. You studied that subject. You know that the answer is somewhere in your head. But unfortunately, you are unable to retrieve that information. You try to remember the answer in all possible ways, trying to dig deep inside of your memory, trying to remember what you studied. But it just can't, and time is running out, and you leave the answer field blank, and you don't get the score you could have gotten, and that could make you fail your exam or even cost you a job promotion. Why do people's minds go blank like this? Why do we sometimes fail to remember the answer to a question, or somebody's name, or the password we created to log in on a new app? When this happens, we have a problem in the third and last process of formation of memories: encoding, storage, and retrieval. Now we're having problems in the process of retrieval. Retrieving is the act of remembering information that is stored in the long-term memory. In the recent episode of this Study Arata series, we've been talking in depth about how our memory works. First of all, we saw there are three kinds of memory: sensory memory, short-term memory, and long-term memory. Sensory memory registers everything that your five senses are able to capture, but this information stays in your mind for no more than just a few seconds. Short-term memory, or working memory, is capable of selecting some pieces from all that information, something between 5 to 9 units of information. Yet, long-term memory can remember the most important memories for days, or even years after you received that information. It is as if it were a funnel with a filter. At the top of the funnel, all five senses capture everything that happens around you. Only a few things pass through the filter, and to the middle of the funnel, this is your short-term memory. And only the most important information goes to the bottom of the funnel at the end, and this is your long-term memory. In order for all of this to happen, there are three processes by which memories are formed: encoding, storage, and retrieval. Encoding is the act of getting a piece of information from your short-term memory to your long-term memory. And to do that, you can use techniques like rote rehearsal, chunking, mnemonic devices, self-referencing, and spacing. We've talked about all of these encoding techniques in episode number 20 of the Study Arata series. Storage is your brain's ability to retain that information until the time you need it. Storage was the subject of our previous episode. Retrieval is the act of remembering the information that was stored in your long-term memory at the moment when you need that information, at the time of a test, at the time when you see that person that you were introduced to at some party or event, at the time when an app is asking you for the password that you created. In today's conversation, we're going to understand in detail how the process of retrieval of memories works. Your brain uses some cues to retrieve information from your long-term memory. Whenever you try to remember something that is in your memory, you're activating the retrieval process. And what defines whether you're going to actually retrieve that memory or not is the use of retrieval cues. Mainly, the cues you left during encoding. In order to retrieve the information that isn't stored in your long-term memory, you need to associate one of those retrieval cues with the cues that were present at the time that you encoded that memory. That is why the way you encode a memory is so important. An example of a cue would be the context in which you encoded certain information. Researchers conducted some experiments to see the impact that the learning context has when a student needs to retrieve information. And in this experiment, the students of a diving course were split into two groups. One of the groups received information underwater. Another group received information on shore. Those who received information underwater got more right answers when they did the tests in the water. And the ones who received information on ground, they got more answers correct when they did the tests on shore. Another example of retrieval cue is state-dependent memory. If you're feeling sad, it's more likely that you will remember information that you learned when you were feeling sad. If you're feeling anxious, you will remember more easily the information that you learned while you were anxious. Even if you were drunk, it is easier for you to remember information that you received when you were drunk. This rule is quite easy to understand. When you encode information, your brain creates a memory associating some cues with that encoding moment. At the time of information retrieval, your brain looks for some cues that can be associated with the point at which you acquired the memory. And this is why the encoding process is so important. If you encoded something using the chunking technique, you will need to remember the groups at the moment of retrieval. If you used a mnemonic cue, you will need to remember the mnemonic cue when you are retrieving. And if you used self-referencing, you'll need to remember the story that you made up. Your memories are more often reconstructed than retrieved. Our brain doesn't work like a computer that retrieves memories exactly as they were saved. First of all, not all memories we have stored in our memory are accessible. And some of them, they stay in the unconsciousness, and we are unable to access them whenever we want. In addition to that, when you manage to access one of those memories and retrieve information from your memory, this memory doesn't look exactly the same way it looked when it was first registered. This difference between the fact itself and what we remember about the fact happens because the person who registered the memory is not the same person who is now trying to retrieve that memory. You have changed, the context has changed, and your interpretation of some events also has changed. And that is why a lot of psychologists say that the process of memory retrieval should actually be called reconstruction of memories. Every time you retrieve a memory, you change slightly what you're remembering. These small changes depend on your state-dependent memory, on your humor, on the references you acquired with time. Everything that happened between the moment you encoded a memory and the moment you try to retrieve that memory affects the way you retrieve the information. And this happens even with memories of great emotional impact, such as the birth of a child or death of a family member. Even if you think that you remember exactly how these facts happened, even so, you are reconstructing some of these details. Our memory is not like a film recorded in our mind. We don't reproduce memories exactly as they happened. There is always some reconstruction. There are three ways of retrieving information from your memory. When you try to retrieve information that is in your memory, your brain uses one of the three main methods: free recall, cued recall, and recognition. The first and most difficult method is free recall. Free recall is very similar to the example that we gave at the beginning of this conversation. You're there with a test in front of you, and you try through all possible means to remember the answer to an open question. In free retrieval, it is very common for the brain to only remember some pieces of information, and it's usually easier to remember what you learned at the beginning or at the end. The second method is cued recall. For example, let's say that a test asks you about the first planet on the solar system. The answer starts with the letter M written before a blank space for you to complete the name of the planet. So this letter M, it gives you a clue, and this clue lets you know that the answer probably is either Mercury or Mars. Now, your brain's work is just to retrieve information, and that's much easier. And the third method is recognition. In this method, your brain only needs to recognize which is the right answer, and that is why recognition is a comparison method. For example, a multiple choice test in which different answers are presented as alternatives for you to be selecting the right one. Your task simply consists of recognizing the right information among the many presented alternatives. Some specialists point to the existence of a fourth method called relearning, but relearning isn't exactly the same as retrieval of memories. For example, let's say that you learned to play piano when you were a child and afterwards you didn't play it again. And decades later, you decide to play the piano again, but you've forgotten everything that you knew. Now you have to relearn how to play the piano again. So in this theory, this relearning process should be slightly easier than learning how to play the piano from the very beginning, from the first time. So we can focus on the main three methods of memory retrieval: free recall, cued recall, and recognition. These are the techniques you have to use to remember information whenever you need, and in order to be successful at retrieval, the secret is having used a good memory technique when you are encoding that memory. Retrieval is a key process when it comes to memory. If you can't remember something whenever you need to, well, it's worthless to understand how human memory works. To retrieve memories well, you need to follow the cues that were left during the encoding process of these memories. There are techniques to do all of this, and that is why I invite you to visit arata.se/intelligence, so then we can work together in a detailed training for you to have a perfect memory.